नमस्ते, स्वागतम। श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। एज वी शेड्यूल्ड, वी कंप्लीटेड द ऋषि परंपरा प्रोग्राम लास्ट टू डेज। नाउ टुडे वी आर स्टार्टिंग अ गुरु परंपरा इन अ धर्ममूलम प्रोग्राम। धर्ममूलम इज अ फेसिलिटेटेड बाय जगद्गुरु आदिशंकराचार्य परंपरा पीठम। वी आर हैप्पी टू हैव अ सुदर्शन शर्मा गारु, the Vedic West University Tirupati Vice Chancellor.
Namaskar.
I'll request Sudarshan Shamgar to just give us a few words Dharma program. And sir, Sudarshan Shamgar, please.
Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwarah, गुरु साक्षात परम ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। रेस्पेक्टेड सर्स एंड यंग फ्रेंड्स, टुडे आई एम वेरी हैप्पी टू गेट मायसेल्फ एसोसिएटेड विद ऑल ऑफ यू द एलाइट पीपल द डिवोटीज ऑफ कांची कामकोटि पीठम। आई विल एट द आउटसेट कंग्रेचुलेट श्री कुंपेल्ल शर्मा गारु for the initiative he has taken to organize this type of series of webinars, which are very much useful under the present circumstances. Sirs and friends, you all know dharma is the root cause of this world, for its sustenance, for its maintenance, for its progression. Dharma is necessary. Without dharma, there is no life. The life will depends upon dharma, and the dharma is preached by Veda. Veda can be understood only through the grace of a guru. These two topics that were wisely chosen by Sharma garu are interdependent, interlinked. Dharma is the basis, and without guru you cannot understand dharma. So guru parampara is also so great, especially in India. We have a strong roots for the tradition of gurus. Fortunately, the Shankara avatara, Shankara Bhagavatpada, has established the pithas throughout the country to protect dharma. And the protection of dharma he understood and implemented through the parampara of gurus. That's what I understand. And today in our program we are very lucky to have Dr. Kalyan Sharma, a promising, I used to tell about him, a promising young scholar. Now I can tell him an erudite young scholar. So we are very eager to listen to him. He is a great scholar. He also belongs to a very rich guru parampara. His father is a great scholar who has taught Nyaya, Vedanta and other shastras to so many disciples. And our today's speaker, Sri Kalyan Sharma garu, also had his primary teaching with his father and then under various scholars to polish his scholarship. Today we are very fortunate enough to have elderly scholar and others to boost the atmosphere of this webinar. Thank you, Sharma garu.
Thank you, sir. I'll request Arvind Sitaraman to give a brief about Kanchi Kamakoti Peetham. About Arvind, Arvind is dedicated to the seva He managing a lot of projects in a Kamakotipetam. In a past, he worked as a Cisco CEO, had contributed to many technologies and the patents. He also won a lot of awards. It is a brief about him. It is a privilege to have him in. And I kindly request Arvind to take over and explain about Kanchi Kamakotipetam and Guru Parampara briefly before we hand over to the Kalyan Garu about Guru Parampara program today. Arvind?
Okay. Sadashiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam Om. Thank you, Sharma. Respected Sudarshana Sharma Garu, Kalyana Shastri Garu, Namaste. And all of you who attending this class.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you then. Yeah, please continue then.
Okay. So, Sri Sudarshana Sharma Garu had very beautifully talked about the importance of a guru, and Sri Kalyana Shastri Garu is going to get into great details about Guru Mahima and so on. And Sri Sudarshana Sharma Garu had briefly talked about Adi Shankara. I want to spend next 5 minutes giving a brief history of Adi Shankaracharya, how he started, and how this matam, the platform that is giving you this knowledge today and bringing all these scholars to you, how it started, so that you can understand the mahima, the greatness of who is giving you this knowledge. So the first page, Sharma. So Adi Shankaracharya was born in Kerala, in a place called Kaladi. In English calendar, according to English calendar, comes to about 509 BCE, before the Common Era. And in Kali calendar, in our traditional calendar, it is 2593. So this was about 2500 years ago. And at a very early age, at five, he had his Upanayanam conducted. And he became a sannyasi at eight. And at a very early age, at that kind of an age, in those days when there were so many forests and dangers on the road, he left to seek his guru, Sri Govinda Bhagavat Padacharya, on the banks of Narmada. So he walked all the way from Kerala to Narmada in central India. So once he learned from his guru, remember when he was born, he was given only 16 years to live. That was the conditions of his birth. And within 16 years, he had written so many bhashyams. Between age 8 and 16, he had written a lot of bhashyams. Specifically, his bhashyam on the Brahma Sutra was so phenomenal that Sri Veda Vyasa, who was the chronicler of the Mahabharata epic, gave him an extra 16 years to live and to contribute to the world. So as part of his life, his very short life, 32 years, he then went to Kailasham, Mount Kailash, where he went and prayed to Lord Shiva and Parvati and wrote several great works there. And Shiva was very pleased by his work. And he gave him 5 lingas. He installed 4 of the lingas in different places in India, but kept 1 for himself. And that linga is still available at the Kanchi Matam. And a daily 3 times puja is done by Periva himself to this linga. So unbroken tradition of puja to this linga. And then what he did was he created Advaita Kshetrams or Matams, Peetams, in 4 different places in India. And finally, he decided to come and settle down at Kanchipuram. That was his 5th Peetam, as his own Peetam. And he called it the Sarvajna Peetam, Mula Sarvajna Peetam. And he retained the Yoga Linga for himself. And he did puja for puja there. The question is, why is Kanchipuram important? Kanchipuram was one of the four most important centers of learning in India at those days. It is one of the seven moksha puris. It is believed that if you die in Kanchipuram, you attain moksham, because there are so many great rishis who had lived there and so many great gurus who had lived there and so many beautiful kshetrams that are there. So anybody who goes there will get a pure heart and will automatically attain moksha. It is also one of the Panchabhuta kshetrams. It is the Prithvi kshetram. Panchabhutam are the five elements that we call it. Prithvi is earth. So this is the earth kshetram. It is also one of the Pancha Shakti kshetrams. And so it has got many, many, you know, important elements as to why he chose Kanchipuram. Then what happened was, he, as part of his stay there, he appointed a successor to his Peetam. And he was a very young boy also, not very much, older than you, all of you. He was very, very young. And he was given a name, Sarva Gnyatman. So it's Sarva Gnyanendra Saraswati. And Sureshwaracharya, who was the eldest of all his Sishyas, was appointed as a guardian for this new guru that was there. And then he attained sannyasam in Kanchipuram. Moksham in Kanchipuram. He attained Siddhi in Kanchipuram. And his Adhishtanam is still there in the Kamakshi temple. So when you go into Kamakshi temple next time, make sure you ask where Shankaracharya's Adhishtanam is, and you would see it on the right hand side. It's still there. So he, in a very short period of time, he established that. So since that time, there have been 70 great gurus. The 70th one is who's on the Peetam, who's the Peetadhipati now, and 69 of them had already been there, and they've all attained Siddhi. And they've been trying to work with very young people and old people, regardless of religion, regardless of caste, regardless of ethnicity, getting them to understand the importance of dharma and our way of life, so that they can all achieve to a better state in life. So this is a very brief about the Kanchi Peetam. If you guys want to hear more about the activities of Kanchi Matam and what are the various things that we are doing, then please do let Sharma Garu know, and he will set up a follow-up meeting where we can get into details about the various programs of the Kanchi Matam, Kanchi Shri Matam. Sharma, back to you.
Arvind, thank you.
Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwara, Guru Sakshat Param Brahma, Smai Shri Gurave Namaha.
I hope
voice is audible to everybody. Firstly,
yes, sorry, it is clear. You can
go ahead. Yes. Firstly, my pranams to Sri Kumpala Sharma Garu for conducting such a nice program and trying to take our tradition to all the next generation children and kids. And secondly, my pranams to Sri Arvind Garu for such a beautiful introduction about Kanchikama Koti Peetam, and especially about Adi Shankara Bhagavat Pada and his contribution to our tradition. And my humble salutations also go to Professor Sudarshan Sharma Garu, who is the Vice Chancellor of Vedika Vishwavidyalayam, who is like a father figure to me. So it gives me immense pleasure to talk about Guru Parampara and the significance of Guru and its parampara of such a learned figure like Sudarshan Sharma Garu and other elders present here. And a warm welcome to all the participants also to this program. So I have made a small PowerPoint presentation, so that people say that there are two types of communication. One is visual communication and one is oral communication. If it is just limited to oral communication, there is always a chance that you people might fall asleep or you people might get bored. So keeping this in mind, I have made a small PowerPoint presentation which will, you know, keep you visually intact also. So I'm sharing. Yes. Thank you, Mahati, for a lovely introduction. Thank you so much for that. Now I'm sharing my presentation. So, and I will go directly. Can everybody view the presentation?
Yeah, we can see.
Right. Just before I enter this, I will tell you a backstory of why this particular topic has been given to me. And actually has not even been given to me. So as part of the Dharma Moolam series, when Sri Kumbhila Sharma Garu had contacted me and he told me that these are some of the parameters which we want to focus on the program, I said that I want to, if at all I am given an opportunity, I would want to choose something on Guru and the Guru Parampara, because this topic is something which is very close to me, because I have also undergone traditional Shastra Adhyayana in the traditional Guru Parampara system, and I have seen what how a Guru can bring about a change in the Shishya. So I said I will take only this topic and I will not take any other topic, because I am frankly speaking ineligible to talk about any other topic. But since this is something which is not, I want to speak on this, and Sri Kumbhila Sharma Garu has been gracious enough to accept that and, you know, give me this. Actually, my father, my guru, who happens to be my father also, he was supposed to speak on Guru and Guru Parampara, but my father is not so conversant in English. So I am just a representation of my father. Whatever he has told me about Guru and Guru Parampara, I will be speaking. So if all the merits will go to my father, and if there are any shortcomings, those will be my shortcomings. All right. So having said this, I will start my lecture today. I can't call it a lecture because elders are here. So I would not dare to call it a lecture, but my humble ramblings on a vast topic of Guru and Guru Parampara. So everybody, all the speakers who have spoken in this session or any other session, they start with this lovely shloka. Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwara, Guru Sakshat Param Brahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. And this shloka happens to be the first shloka which is taught to us as children and kids also. Right? So, also since a lot of children are here in this, I would like to keep this session interactive also. And once in a while, I'll keep asking you very easy questions just to, you know, for curiosity and, you know, test. I would not say test, but, you know, just to prick your curiosity. Yeah. So this shloka is what we have been taught at our earliest stages. And everybody knows what the meaning of the shloka. Can anybody volunteer here and tell me the meaning of the shloka?
Can we? Yes,
please go ahead.
First of all, any question, please raise a hand and then we will open up their mic, and then after that answer it, then put it in mute. Okay, thank you. So, and I'll give a
Guru is Brahma, Guru is Vishnu, Guru is Shiva. Guru is Sakshat Param Brahma. He is Param Brahma. The first Sri Gurave Namaha. That Guru, I give my pranams.
Yes, very good, Narayana. Thank you so much. Yeah, this is what the meaning of the shloka is, but there is so much, you know, we can speak for hours together on just this one shloka. So I'll raise a small question here. So when Narayana had said Guru is Brahma, who is Brahma? So according to our tradition, Brahma is the one who creates the Srishti or Samsara or the world. And Vishnu is the God who operates And Maheshwara, Shiva is the one who destroys the entire Srishti Prakriya. Now, since Brahma has already been said, what is the need to again say Parabrahma? So, this is a very small question. So, when they have already mentioned that Guru is Brahma, what is the need to again mention that Guru is again Parabrahma? So, can anybody answer this? Why is Brahma used twice? Is there a difference between Brahma and Parabrahma? Yes, I think again Narayana has raised his hand. Let's see what he says.
Brahma garu emo srishti chese vadu parabrahma emo anta ante anta unde vadu.
Yes, yes.
అంటే ఇప్పుడు పరమాత్మ లాగా
పరబ్రహ్మ. చాలా చక్కగా చెప్పారు నారాయణ గారు, వెరీ నైస్. యా, సో మోర్ ఆర్ లెస్, సో వెన్ వి సే గురు ఇస్ బ్రహ్మ, బ్రహ్మ ఇస్ మోర్ ఆఫ్ అ పొజిషన్, అ పోస్ట్. బ్రహ్మ హ్యాస్ క్రియేటెడ్ ద వరల్డ్ అకార్డింగ్ టు ద ఇన్స్ట్రక్షన్స్ ఆఫ్ పరబ్రహ్మ. పరబ్రహ్మ ఇస్ ద యూనివర్సల్ కాన్షియస్నెస్, ఆర్ ఇస్ వాట్ వి కాల్ ఎస్ Brahma, Jiva and Brahma, Abheda in Advaita Siddhanta, that Parabrahma, who is the consciousness, that is Parabrahma, and this Brahma and Vishnu and Maheshwara are just, you know, create operators and destroyers of the Prapancha we see. So there is a subtle difference between Brahma and Parabrahma. I congratulate Narayana who has, you know, said the answer. Yes.
సారీ, ఇది శ్రీకృతి అక్కడ పక్కన.
సరే సరే, ఓకే 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 ఓకే, శ్రీకృతి చెప్పింది, వెరీ నైస్, కంగ్రాట్స్. సో నౌ ది పాయింట్ ఐ వాంట్ టు మేక్ హియర్ ఇస్, నౌ యాజ్ పర్ అవర్ ట్రెడిషన్ ఫర్ క్రియేటింగ్ వీ హ్యావ్ అ సెపరేట్ గాడ్, ఫర్ ఆపరేటింగ్ ద ఎంటైర్ వరల్డ్ ఆర్ ద క్రియేషన్ వీ హ్యావ్ అ సెపరేట్ గాడ్, అండ్ ఫర్ డిస్ట్రాయింగ్ వీ హ్యావ్ అ సెపరేట్ గాడ్. బట్ the utkrushtata, or you know, the greatness of Guru is he can do all the three things all by himself. So each god has been entrusted with one separate duty, but the greatness of a guru or a sadguru or a jagatguru is such, this guru, even though he is a single entity, he can do all the three things, all the three activities which have been given separately to a god. So that shows the greatness, the magnitude of the guru in our tradition. So having made these brief introductions, I will slowly go to my next point. So when I say that guru is the creator, guru is the operator, and guru is the destroyer, how can guru be a destroyer? Guru is supposed to be very kind, very compassionate. Then why will Guru destroy anything? There is a small question here. So now for that, I would like to give you a small story in our Mahabharata. Okay. So, you know, there were Kauravas and Pandavas, and Mahabharata basically is all about the war fought between the Pandavas and the Kauravas, right? So there was this person called Karna, right? Everybody knows Karna, I'm assuming. There was this character called Karna, right?
Yeah.
So this, yeah, Karna, he had a guru. Can somebody tell me who was Karna's guru?
Parashurama.
Oh, very good, very good. You people are very intelligent. Nice. So Karna learnt all his vidya near Parashurama. But what Karna did was he hid his identity before he went and, you know, asked his guru. He lied and then he learned. But later on, when Parashurama, his guru, knew about his identity due to a particular incident, he said, whatever I have taught you, you will not remember it when you need it the most. So a guru, even though he teaches us, he even has the capacity to take it away from us, right? A guru is always kind, a guru is always compassionate. But if the Shishya or the disciple is not going in the path shown as laid down by the Guru, or is not being righteous, or is not being truthful and honest, then Guru will always take back whatever he has taught. He has the power, right? So this can be seen in this instance of Karna in Mahabharata, where Karna, he learned the entire Dhanurvidya and other Vidyas from his Guru Parashurama. But at the time of battle, during the Kaurava Pandava battle, when he needed his Vidya the most, he could not remember it. That shows the power of a Guru. So this shloka beautifully says that even though we have three different gods for three different nations, the Guru exceeds all these three gods, because he, even though he is single, he has the power to do all the three activities which were given to separate gods. That shows the greatness of Guru, and this shloka basically shows us, tells us about the greatness of a Guru, which is why right from our childhood, I think the first shloka which we teach to our children is this in most of the households and families, right? So having said this, now before going into what are the qualities of a Guru and who is a Guru, I would like to answer a very simple question. What is the need of a Guru? Okay, these days, you know, in current world, everything is on a need basis, right? If there is a need, only then we will do something. If there is no need, if the need does not arise, then we do not do anything. This itself is said in our shastras also. Prayojanam anuddishya namandopi pravartate. Prayojanam is some sort of a need, necessity. Without any need or necessity, even a fool will not do anything. So similarly, when we are talking about a Guru, what is the need of a Guru? This is the first question, and this question needs to be answered. Only once when we have answered this, then we can go on to various other topics like what are the qualities of a Guru and what is Guru Parampara, who are all the important Gurus in our Parampara and all this. So I will try to answer this question first. So, Acharyavan Purusho Veda. This is a small saying in Veda. Acharyavan Purusho Veda. Everybody knows what Vedas are. Vedas are the foundation. The foundation of our Hindu Samprada. Our Sanatana Dharma, they are like the pillars. They are the pillars. So when I say pillars, when you need to construct a building, I'm sure you little kids, when you have played using your Legos, you will have to construct a foundation, a firm foundation. And only after the foundation, you can start building bigger blocks on it. If your foundation is not concrete, there is always a chance when your entire structure will collapse. Similarly, our Hindu tradition is totally based on the Vedas. Now, there are four Vedas. Can anybody tell me what are the four Vedas?
Veda, Samaveda, Yajurveda.
That's very good. I'm very lucky to have a very enthusiastic set of children and kids listening to this. Yes, very good. We have four Vedas: Rigveda, Yajurveda, Samaveda, and Atharvaveda. Now, Acharyavan Purusho Veda. So Veda comes from the root with. With means jnanam, knowledge. Vedas are nothing but repositories. They are the treasures, treasure houses of knowledge. Now, Acharyavan Purushaha Veda. What this sentence means is, the knowledge of Vedas, we cannot get the knowledge of Vedas without a Guru. So there is knowledge and there is us. The Guru is the link between this knowledge and us. He is the person who will bridge us between this endless repositories of knowledge to us. So Acharyavan Purusho Veda, this Veda Vakya talks about the dire need of a Guru. Guru is very necessary. The next again. Then again, Shankara Bhagavat Pada in Kesha, he says, Shariram Sarupam Tathava Kalatram Yashascharu Chitram Dhanam Meru Tulyam मनश्चेन्न लग्नम गुरोरग्रि पद्मे ततः किम ततः किम ततः किम ततः किम. दिस इज अ वेरी ब्यूटिफुल श्लोक विच सेज समबडी हूज शरीर. वॉट इज शरीर? शरीर इज योर बॉडी. स्वरूपम, ही इज वेरी हैंडसम, और दैट लेडी इज वेरी ब्यूटिफुल. समबडी हू हैज अ वेरी lustrous body, he has a very he is a very handsome person, and then his kalatram, his wife, is also very beautiful, and then yashaha, his fame, he has a lot of good fame and reputation, and then his dhanam, his wealth, he has a lot of wealth, which is meru tulyam. What is meru? Meru is, as per our Puranas, meru is a, what is meru? Meru is a mountain. Meru parvata. Yeah.
Meru parvata.
Yes, meru is a, yes, meru parvata. Now in current day you can find meru parvata. So if as per current geological situations, there is a parvata beyond Gangotri. You know, we have Ganga Nadi. Ganga Nadi comes from a glacier called Gomukh. Beside Gomukh there are three mountains called Bhagirathi Parvatas. If you go a little ahead, there is a huge meadow there. It's called Tapovan. Bang opposite to Tapovan, there is a mountain. It is called Meru Parvata. Okay, so Meru Parvata is, suppose the reason they have used Meru Parvata here is Meru Parvata is very tall. So when you say Dhanam Meru Tulyam, it means it is a simile. So he has wealth. He has so much wealth. That is what the meaning here is. But so all these speak about materialistic wealth. Okay, you are very beautiful, you are very handsome, then you have a lot of fame and reputation, and you have a lot of wealth. But if his manaha, if his thoughts are not on the lotus feet of his guru, what is the point in acquiring all such material wealth? That is what this shloka says. So this shloka, which is written by our Jagadguru Adi Shankaracharya itself, this talks about the need of a guru. Then again, in the second, I have put another shloka, which is again in the same Upadesha Guru Ashtakam. Kalatram dhanam putra pautradi sarvam griham bandhavaha sarvam etadhi jatam manaschet na lagnam guru ragngri padme tatakkim 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 tatakkim. Almost the same sort of meaning is being told even in the shloka. Kalatram dhanam putra pautradi sarvam griham bandhavaha sarvam etaddi jatam. So all sorts of materialistic wealth we are having, but if our thoughts, if our mana, our thoughts, our thinking is not embedded on the lotus feet of our guru, then what is the point in acquiring all such materialistic thoughts? Okay, so this also talks about the need of a guru. Then again in Bhagavad Gita, can anybody tell me between which two personalities was Bhagavad Gita told?
Krishna and Arjuna.
Yes, yes, very good.
So during the,
yes, yes, very good. Thank you. So during the Mahabharata war, when Arjuna was having doubts regarding fighting his own brothers, then Krishna took him and he gave him an Upadesha which has come down to us as Bhagavad Gita. In Bhagavad Gita, there is a shloka which says, Tasmat pramanam te karya karya vyavasthitau. The meaning of this is, Shastram is pramanam. Shastram here, Shastram is not Vedanta Shastram, Advaita Shastram. It could mean that, or Shastram usually means Veda. Okay. Shastram is nothing but Veda. Veda is pramanam. Pramanam is, what is pramanam? Vedam is the final verdict. You can say this. Vedam is the final verdict. Final verdict. But when? Karya karya vyavasthitau. What to do and what not to do. How will we know what should we do and what should we not do? All this has been told in our Vedas. Vedas have told us, do this, don't do this. It has showed us the path. It has showed us what is good, and it has even showed us what is bad also. But how will we know what is us? So this Shastra Pramanam, how will people like us know? there is an acute need of a guru. The guru will bring out the knowledge then in the Vedas and he will communicate it to us. Thus, there is definitely a need of a guru in our lives. Okay. And then there is again a very beautiful Subhashita, which talks about the need of a guru. Vina Gurubhyo Gunaniradhibhyo Janati Tattvam Na Vichakshanopi Akarna Dirghayita Lochanopi Deepam Vina Pashyati Nandhakare. This is a very beautiful shloka which says, which talks about the necessity of a guru. Yeah. So, one can be very intelligent, one can be very bright, one can be very knowledgeable. But his intellect and his knowledge will bear no fruit without the existence of a guru in his life. So, Sanskrit shlokas or Sanskrit Subhashitas have this analogies. They're known as similes in English literature. You know, everybody knows what a simile is. As smooth as silk, as brave as a lion. When we say all this, it is known as similes. We give analogies. So here, this Subhashit also talks about a similar analogy. Analogy ante oka comparison ivadam. Okay. So the comparison here is, even if we have very sharp sight, you know, so many people have short-sightedness and long-sightedness, and that is why they will need spectacles. But somebody without spectacles who is supposed to have very good sight, can that person see anything dark? No. How can we see something in darkness? For example, our parents have asked us to go and get that book from that room. We go running to that room. But imagine if that room is in pitch darkness. It is sinking in pitch darkness. Can we find out where that particular book is? No. What will we do there? The first thing we do is we switch on the light. This light is making us see the book. Similarly, even if a person is very intelligent or very witty, bright and clever, all this will not matter unless and until he does not have a guru. Right? So now these are some of the shlokas or Subhashitas in our literature which talk about the necessity of a guru. So we haven't established the fact that we need a guru for, you know, all sorts of things in our life. Now that the fact has been established that you need a guru in your life, we will go to the next topic. Okay, right. During this topic, which is the necessity of a guru, I would like to share a very small story. Right. There was a lion. The lion. What is the title for the lion? The lion is known as the... Anybody can tell me this? What is the lion known as?
King of the jungle.
Yes. Very good. Lion is known as the king of the jungle. Right. So, there was a particular lion which had a very small... which had a cub also. The lion, baby lion is known as a cub. Right. So what happened, unfortunately, the lion unfortunately died and the cub was left all alone. The entire family of the lions and the lionesses, they perished and only the cub was remaining. Then what happened was, there was a group of sheep which were nearby, and one sheep, it took pity on this little cub of a lion. And it took it as its own and started rearing him and started giving him milk. And it's starting rearing him as his own sheep, right? So, days passed by and this lion, this cub grew up to be a big lion, right? Then, even though it is a lion, it thought of itself to be a sheep only, okay? It forgot its swabhava, its nature. Then, after a few years, when this cub had become a big lion, another group of lions suddenly started hunting this pack of sheep. Then, unfortunately, what happened? This lion started killing the sheep, and then As soon as the lions attacked, this lion also started, this lion, it started running out of fear. The lions were surprised. How can a lion, looking at another lion, get scared and start run away? Then the new lion stopped and, you know, looked at the lion and said, "Fear me not. Don't get scared. I want to know what is it that you are scared about." Then he said, "The lion will always kill a sheep. I am a sheep. Then how do you expect me not to be scared?" This is the question the cub which had grown into the lion had posed. Then the lion understood that this is a lion, but it had forgot its roots. It had forgot its true nature. So then the lion took the other lion to a small pond where there was water. And then the lion showed the reflection of the sheep lion. I like to call the lion as sheep lion. That which was raised by a sheep, but which was actually a lion, I'll call it a sheep lion. Right? So when it showed the sheep lion, look into the water, what do you see? Then both the lions were beside and they could see the reflection. And then this lion and the sheep lion were looking the same. Now this startled, this surprised the sheep lion. When the lion started roaring, the sheep lion could only let out a bleat. Sheep's bleat. Meh. The lion also let out a bleat. Then it was surprised. But then the lion reminded him of its true form. Okay. The lion reminded him of its true form. And then the sheep then realized that, no, I was born a lion, but for a brief duration of time, I was raised by a sheep, and then I forgot my true nature and I thought I was a sheep, but ultimately I'm a lion. And then it came to its true nature, and then it also understood that it is a lion. Now, the reason I have told you this story is we are bound by the samsara, and we live in a lot of maya and ajnana and illusion. And then our true nature is nothing but Parabrahma. Now, in the story, the sheep lion is nothing but Jiva. The lion in its true form is nothing but Parabrahma. But to know, for a Jiva to know that he is Parabrahma, he needs somebody to remind him. In our case, that reminder is nobody else but Guru. So that is why we need Guru in our daily lives. Also, again, there is another story. Since there are a lot of kids, I would like to talk more on, give two or three more anecdotes of the past. So there was a learned person who had three children. And just before his death, he called three children and he said, "Sons, there is a small box which I have put in your almirah. After I die, you people open the box only if you have any problems. If you have some problems in your life, only then you need to open the box and the solution for your box will be there." Now, the father ultimately passed, and then the children, they were doing their daily activities, and suddenly they found themselves to be in a situation where they had lost all their money. Then the elder brother, the eldest of all the three, he suddenly remembered his dad's parting words. He said, "Brothers, father told us that in case of any disaster or any problem, he asked us to open the box and we will find the solution to the problem." So they all decided to open the box, and they opened the box. Now, when they opened the box, the father, he had written something in code language, and in normal language there he had written, "You will find a lot of wealth under the shikara of a temple." Everybody understands what the shikara of a temple means? Shikara, the main big monument which you can see when you enter a temple, it is known as the shikara, the tall structure, yeah, which is there when you enter a temple. That is known, yeah, as shikara. Right. So, but if you know that there is wealth under the shikara, you can't just go and randomly take it. You need to dig it. Right, you need to take a plow and you need to dig it. But this was a temple which belonged to the village. even though the brother's father, the father, elderly person, was supposed to be a very respected figure in the family, yet breaking or, you know, trying to demolish the temple, taking it, will not be accepted by anybody. But after a lot of negotiations and everybody and other things, they finally managed to convince all the local villagers and they dug up the shikara, only to be heartbroken. They had not found a single piece of penny. They had not even found a single penny, not one single coin. Then they were very saddened and heartbroken. Then the father's friend, who was also a very learned person, who was very wise, he had come and he had heard of this incident and he came running to that to the rescue of the brothers. And he said, why did you do all this? Why did you dig the temple? Then the brother said that, no, we had a lot of problems. And my father said, when you have a problem, open the box and then you will find it. But then he said, okay, show me what was written in the box. So I told you, a part of it was written in a code and the part was written in normal language. So when the wise man saw that, he understood the code. So he played the part of a guru in this. So he understood the code and he said, your father did not just mean dig the shikara and you will find it right under the shikara. He left it in the code. The code, this, I have deciphered your code. I have deciphered your code. And he said that at one particular auspicious day in one particular masa, when the sun shines in one particular direction, it casts a shadow. So if there is something, if there is an object and there is light here, if it is an opaque object which will not let light pass through, it will cast a shadow, right? Similarly, because of the movements of the sun will, you know, keep shifting its position all through the year because of the revolution of the earth, right? So because of this, I have deciphered your code, and this particular masa, on this particular day, Shikara's shadow will be cast on the ground at this particular point. Your father had asked you to dig that particular point, which you people could not understand. Having said that, he asked all the three brothers to again dig it. And now, after the instruction of this wise man, they started digging, and then to their surprise, they found heaps of gold buried down there. So the reason I'm telling you this story is, even in our lives, we sometimes are sinking in ignorance, or even we might know something, but we might know it only partially. We might not know the true essence of something. So this is where the guru comes in, and the guru will eradicate this darkness, this ignorance inside us, and then he will show us the right path. That is why the necessity of guru is there in our daily lives, and it is must that we need a guru so that we go through a sanmarga, the righteous path. Okay. Having said this, I will move to the next topic, which is, who is a guru? Now, having established the fact that we need a guru and the necessity of a guru is very, you know, it is very prevalent in our lives, after that question has been answered, the next question which needs to be answered is, who is a guru and what are the qualities of a guru, right? So, you know, English language, even though it is an international language, if you go back to the origins of English, English in itself had very few hundreds of words. That's it. English language is more of loan words. You have Latin words, you have Greek words, you have words from Saxony, Anglo-Saxony, and all this, which is not the case in Sanskrit. Sanskrit is a classical language. Sanskrit is known as Deva Bhasha, Gairvani. It is the language of the gods. It means that Sanskrit language has this abundance in it, and it gives a speaker endless amounts of freedom to express. So according to Sanskrit, one meaning of guru is used in terms of large weight. Okay. But again, a single word can have so many meanings, right? So what is that particular term which is known in English? What do we call that? A single word having multiple meanings. What do we call them? Can anybody answer? One word having many meanings.
Synonyms.
It is synonyms. Very good. It is known as Paryaya Padam in local languages, in Telugu or in Sanskrit. Right? It's synonyms. So, this word Guru, it could be different meanings in different contexts. But Guru, normally it means Guru, which means large, hefty, having a weight. Now, if that is the case, then the person who is the tallest or the person who is the most stout, he is supposed to be the Guru. But do we take somebody who is large, you know, the outward appearance, who is very hefty or well-built, do we call him a Guru? No, that is not the intended meaning. Guru here means somebody who possesses, who is large inside, inner greatness. That is what we mean by Guru. Okay. So, to encapsulate this, there is a very beautiful shloka. It says, the Guru has two syllables, Gu and Ru, right? Gu and Ru. So, in Guru, the Gukara means Andhakara. Andhakara is darkness. Okay. Gukarastu Andhakara, Rukarastannivartaka, Andhakara Nirodhitva, Guru Rityabidhiyate. So, the word Guru has two syllables, right? Gu and so this Gu means Andhakara, darkness. And Ru is somebody who will eradicate the darkness. So when you join darkness and eradicating, so how do we term, how do we get the meaning of the word Guru? Somebody who eradicates the darkness. The darkness or the ignorance. So Sanskrit literature has this habit of, you know, using darkness and equating ignorance to darkness. So that is why we use Andhakara here, darkness. Darkness, that is nothing but ignorance, which is nothing but darkness. This darkness and this Guru, he will eradicate us. He will eradicate us by showering his light upon us, and he will show us the right path. We have this suktis in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya. Tamaha is Andhakara, darkness. Jyotirgamaya, lead us onto the path of light from darkness. That is what it says. Okay. And we have so many other shlokas like We have so many other shlokas in the same vein also. Okay. So Guru is somebody who will show us the right path. Okay. General meaning. There are so many other annotations and so many other meanings for who is a Guru. Okay. So now we will see what are the qualities of a Guru. The basic qualities. So there is a wonderful shloka which says, Achinotihi Shastrarthan Achara Sthapanadapi Swayam Acharate Yastu Tasmad Acharya Ujjate. Okay. Somebody, so who is a Guru? Somebody achinoti shastrarthan. Somebody who understands. Somebody who knows shastram. Shastram is nothing but shastram is Veda knowledge and all that. Somebody who knows that very well, who is well versed in that, and who knows the finer nuances. So sometimes there could be two opposing vakyas in Veda. So Guru is somebody who will tell you, even though these are opposing in a superficial level, if you look deep down with sukshma drishti, this means this and this means this, and thus there is no opposition between the two vakyas, right? So a Guru is somebody who shows us achinotihi shastrarthan. Then achara, achara is nothing but tradition, sampradaya, and sthapanat, who is firm in that achara, and ayam acharate, somebody who even follows that, he knows it, and he is very firm in his knowledge of that, and he even follows it in his day-to-day lives. Such a person is known as Guru or Acharya. Okay. There are numerous shlokas. I'm just trying to give just one or two very easy ones. Okay. Then again, there is another huge. This is another. which shloka which talks about what are the qualities which are necessary in a guru. Okay, he says siddham satsampradaye stiram tiradhiyam anagnam shrotriyam brahmanishtam. Okay, these might get very technical for the little kids here in our webinar, so I will not go in depth regarding this. So basically he gives an outline of some 14 qualities which are necessary for a guru. He needs to be and he needs to be brahmanishtam, who is always thinking about Brahman, and he needs to be shrotriya, shruti, something which has been told by shruti, he needs to follow that, and he needs to be full of sattva guna, and he should always speak the truth, and he should be samaniyataya niyataya sadhu vrittya sametam. So these are some of the various qualities. I will try to give the English translations also if there is a need. I will share this PPT along with the English translation so that interested people can look into it. Yeah. Then, okay, I think I'm okay. Huh. So now that we know about gurus, and first we have established the fact that we need a guru, the necessity of a guru. Then, who is a guru? This question we have taken up. And then the next thing is, what about the qualities of a guru? Who can be considered as a guru? Okay. So then the next thing is, we have a beautiful guru parampara. Sri Arvind ji, during his introductory talk, he had spoken about how Adi Shankaracharya, he had established this Advaita parampara, and he, you know, institutionalized that, and he had 5 peethams, and then he gave each peetam to one of his direct shishya, and then that parampara, that is called as avichinna parampara, which means lineage which is not broken. I hope you understand what parampara means. Parampara is nothing but lineage. Lineage is, see, I am here, then, you know, before me, my father, my grandfather, his father, and so on. So we can trace back our lineage, you know. So the beauty of our Indian tradition is, we have 2 types of lineages. One is janmana and one is vidya. Okay, we have 2 types of lineages. Are you following when I mean parampara or lineage? Are you understanding what lineage means? L-I-N-E-A-G-E.
Yes.
Yes, yes, right. Okay, right. Huh? So, janmana means I am born to my father. My father is born to his father. So on, so on, so on, so on. We keep tracing. So, basing on that only, we get our surnames. And basing on that only, after we have Upanayana, when you are doing Abhivandana, you will say, Taittiriya Krishna Yajus Shakadhyayi, so and so, Aham Abhivadaye. That is what we say, right? This is nothing but introducing yourself. We don't go about shaking hands and say, how do you do, hello, and all this. When an elder person comes and we introduce ourselves, this is how our parampara is. We say, I am so and so from this parampara, this Veda Shaka, and here I am prostrating to you. I am bowing down with obedience. I am paying my tributes to you. This is what we say. This is our parampara. So, this is one sort of parampara. The other sort of parampara is known as vidya parampara. You don't need to be linked or bonded via blood with somebody. If you read under him, automatically you are part of his family. You know, I have seen with my own eyes, my father's guru, he had five sons. His name was Mahamopadhyay Sri Madhulapalli Manikya Shastri Garu. He had 5 sons, but for every festival, he would get 6 pairs of clothes. Why? Because my father was also like a son to him. In fact, even more. And my father, he says it with pride. Even to this, when somebody asks him, who are you? He'll say, I am not Ramlal Sharma. I am Madhulapalli Manikya Shastri Garu's disciple. That is how we introduce ourselves. Nobody says my name is so and so. Our parampara says that we are the disciple of so and so. We are the son of so and so. That is our parampara. That is our tradition. So it is very important to know who are the important key personalities in our parampara and the sort of contribution they have done for our tradition. Okay, so just like with janma parampara, we have something known as vidya parampara. So our Kanchipeetam, Kanchi Kamakoti Peetam, it comes under the parampara of Shankaracharya, Jagatguru Shankaracharya, Adi Shankaracharya. So I will come to the significance of Jagatguru Adi Shankaracharya in probably another 5-10 minutes. That will be one of the core topics of my talk here. But before that, I will try to introduce some very important personalities in the Guru Parampara. So whenever somebody who is talking philosophy, he starts his speech, he will start off with Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, that shloka which everybody knows, and then he will use Shankaram, Shankaracharyam, Keshavam, Badarayanam, Sutra Bhashya Krito, Vande Bhagavanto, Punah Punaha. So Adi Shankaracharya is nothing but, he was the incarnation of Lord Shiva himself. Shankaram, Shankaracharyam, and Badarayana. So as per our tradition, there is this Sutra, Bhashya, and Vartika tradition. So Sutra is nothing but, in layman terms, in normal parlance, we can call Sutra as aphorisms, formulae. Okay, we have formulas, right? A plus B whole square is equal to A square plus B square plus 2AB. Everybody must be knowing that here. But what about the proof of that? There is a huge proof for A plus B whole square. A plus B whole square is equal to A square plus B square plus 2AB. This formula requires a huge proof. Similarly, in our tradition, vast amounts of knowledge were embedded in small codes, which are known as sutras. So now this sutra is nothing but, it is a compressed version of a huge amount of knowledge. Now, it is not easy for everybody to understand what is the embedded meaning in a sutra, which is why we had commentaries. So even though the English word is commentary or gloss, there are very subtle differences between what is a sutra, bhashya, vartika, then vritti, and all this. I will not go into all that, but there is a very subtle difference. Okay, so we have this parampara of sutra, bhashya, and then vartika, and all this. So for parampara, the base of the entire Advaita parampara is nothing but the sutras written by Badarayana Vyasa. Okay, but people consider him to be an incarnation of Lord Vishnu himself. Okay, so Badarayana Vyasa, he is the incarnation of Vishnu, and Adi Shankaracharya. So Badarayana had written sutras, and then Shankaracharya had written commentary called Bhashya on these sutras. So these two personalities, who are nothing but incarnations of Lord, I am paying my humble salutations. Sutra Bhashya Krutav. So sutra is done by Badarayana and Bhashya is done by Adi Shankaracharya. Vande Bhagavantav. I am praying to these two gods themselves. Punah Punaha, again and again. That is what this shloka means. And then there, we say this, Narayanam Padmabhuvam Vashishtam Shaktim Cha Tatputra Parasharam Cha Vyasam Shukam Gauda Padam Mahantam Gauda Padam Mahantam Govinda Yogindram Athasya Shishyam Sri Shankaracharyam Athasya Padmapadam Cha Hastamalakam Cha Shishyam Tam Totakam Vartikakaram Anyan Asmad Gurum Santatam Anatosmi. So this is nothing but, there is a hierarchy, there is a krama, oka kramanga, oka line lo. First we pay our obeisance or salutations to Narayana. Nothing but Narayana Swarup, Vishnu it's. And then Padmabhuva. Who is Padmabhuva? Padmabhuva is none other than Chaturmukha Brahma, because he comes from the navel of Lord Vishnu, and he is born on that, he's on that lotus. Padma is nothing but lotus, Padma Bhuva, somebody who is on the lotus. And then Vashishta Rishi, and then Shakti, and then his son Parashara, and then Vyasa, then Shuka Maharshi, then Gauda Padam, then Mahantam, then Govinda Yogindram. So Before Shankaracharya, these are all the gurus. Shankaracharya's immediate guru, his guru was Govinda Yogindram. So he was a sannyasin. So Shankaracharya's guru is Govinda Yogindram. And then his guru was Gaudapada. That is why Gaudapadam Mahantam and then Govinda Yogindram. So Gaudapada and then Govinda Yogindra, then Shankaracharya. So this is the hierarchy. Okay. And then Shankaracharya, like how our Arvindji had told in the introduction, he had, he went to Kailash and he had five lingas, right? So each linga, he did the pratishthapana in one corner of the country. So Kanchipuram has that fifth lingam, one in Sringeri and then in, for the south, which is known as Dakshinamnaya. And towards the east, there is this matha which has been established in Puri. It is known as Purva Amnaya. And one in Dwaraka towards the west of our country, Paschima Amnaya, and towards the north, which is in Joshimath, Badri. Okay. Now, earlier it is Badrika Ashrame itself, but now it is in Joshimath. This Joshimath, this is known as Purva Amnaya. Purva is east. So, four mutts were established by Jagatguru Adi Shankaracharya. And he entrusted the responsibility to one of his, to each of his four disciples. So his disciples come next in line. One is Padmapada, then is Hastamalaka, then Totaka, and then there is a fourth person. The fourth person's name is not given, but he is mentioned here as Vartikakara. You can see here, Totakam Vartikakaram. Vartikakara is, he has written a commentary on the Bhashya. Okay. His name was Sureshwaracharya. This Vartikakara, till here we will talk about the Guru Parampara and then Anyan Asmat Gurun. So after these four, there is again a huge line of gurus. So I am taught by my guru is taught by his guru will be my Paramaguru. So there is a lineage. But then you will have to, the names are not given, but as a whole, we will remember all those gurus in our parampara and we will pay our humble respects. Now, there is a very small question here. Why do we have to remember all these? You can directly read the book. What is the point of remembering the entire thing? So I will try to give a very, very basic example, a worldly example. How many of you know, okay, how many of you know who Harry Potter is here?
I do.
Okay, so Harry Potter, who is Harry Potter? He's basically a wizard, right? Wizard kid, right? And who is the author of the Harry Potter books?
Rowling.
J.K. Rowling.
Okay. Yeah, yes, J.K. Rowling, correct. So, now, whenever J.K. Rowling comes up with a new book, everybody is excited. All the Harry Potter fans, they will run after her. They will follow her tweets and all that. And they will show a lot of enthusiasm. Now, for a very, Harry Potter is a rage among kids and children. But you are eventually remembering the author, right? Similarly, for such a worldly example, if you are remembering the author, these people are nothing but these are the custodians of Atmavidya or Brahma Vidya. So if for a worldly thing, if you are remembering the author, is it not justified that you should remember these custodians of our Sanatana Dharma? Hence, we remember all these important gurus in our parampara. And then every day when you read, whenever you read, it is mandatory that you remember the entire parampara and you pay your your respects. You pay your respects to the parampara and then you go ahead and read. Right? So, this is the parampara and, Vartikakaram Anyan Asmad Gurun Pantatam Anatosmi. Anatiniyara, there is a song. So, Anati is nothing but pranam. My pranams, my humble salutations. That is what the sloka means. So, this sloka talks about the significant personalities in the Guru Parampara. So, just like in tradition, other traditions like Dvaita and Vishishta Dvaita, even they have their own traditions and even they have their own Guru Parampara. Okay. Right. So now I will move to the importance of Adi Shankaracharya, his contribution to the Sanatana Dharma, and how he has brought about a change. Why does he occupy a perennial place when it comes to Indian philosophy or dharma or bhakti or anything for that matter, anything related to our Sanatana Dharma? Adi Shankaracharya's place is like the place of a Dhruvatara, no? Like the pole star, always shining bright. I will come to that now. Yeah. So the significance of Adi Shankaracharya, right? So now there are, everybody knows about Dashavataras. You must have heard about the Dashavataras. Your parents have narrated stories. And I'm pretty sure that the previous speaker, Professor Rani Sadashiv Murthy, even he must have told about the Puranas and the Dashavataras. So in the Dashavataras, every avatara took place. The need for that avatara was to end the reign of a tyrant or a demon. So why did Rama avatara take place? It took place because Ravana was causing a lot of problem. For the eradication of Ravana, to kill Ravana, Vishnu takes the avatar of Rama. Similarly, why did Krishna avatara happen? Because there was some demon known as Kamsa, and then he had to be eliminated. So if you look at the Dashavataras, there was a physical demon present there, and he needed to be eliminated. So I missed out one point earlier while saying about the need of a guru. So if you look at the Dashavataras, look at the avataras. Now Rama and Krishna during their avatara, even they, so I should have mentioned this during the need of the guru, right? So I just remembered it. I would like to point it out here. Since Rama and Krishna have come to the context, Rama and Krishna, they were direct avataras. They were embodiments of Lord Vishnu himself. But then, even though they were godly, still they had to go under the refuge of a guru, right? Who was the guru of Rama? Can anybody tell me?
Vishwamitra.
Yes, very good. Yes. So Vasishta was the court guru. Okay, he was the Rajaguru. And then later Vishwamitra, he says, these princes need to still learn a lot. Please send them along with me and I will teach them. Yes, very good. Both Vasishta and Vishwamitra. So the point I'm trying to make is, even though Lord himself has come in the incarnation, he had an incarnation, till he had to go and, you know, go to the refuge of a guru. Similarly, if you take the example of Lord Krishna, who was the guru of Lord Krishna?
Narayana?
Sandeepa Maharshi.
Yes, Sandeepa Maharshi. Very good. So Lord Krishna also, even though he was direct, Lord Krishna is supposed to be a jnani. Lord Krishna is the one who gave us Gita Amritam. He gave us Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is now, you know, Bhagavad Gita is the essence of everything. So this Gita Amritam has been given by Lord Krishna. But this Lord Krishna himself, he had to go under the refuge of a guru who was Sandeepa Maharshi. So that is the point I'm trying to make, that there is no doubt, you know, when it comes to the necessity of a guru, because the guru is the one who will show us the right path. Okay. So now coming back, the significance of Jagadguru Adi Shankaracharya. Why does he hold a very, very important place in the history of Indian philosophy or Indian dharma or religion? So if you look at Indian history, unfortunately, the Westerners, they attribute Adi Shankaracharya to 8th century AD. So let's not talk about timelines and all, but at the time of Adi Shankaracharya, we had this Anadi Veda parampara. You know, Veda is also known as Shruti. Shruti is nothing but oral transmission. So the guru would teach a Shishya, and the Shishya would, you know, remember it. So even in current day science, memories of two types. So one is oral memory and one is oral memory. So O-R-A-L is oral memory, and the other is A-U-R-A-L, oral memory. So when we read something, we see and we read something, there is an imprint which is formed in our heads that we try to remember. That is one sort of memory, but that is immediate, but it is not long lasting. The other sort of memory is through listening. It will take a lot of time for that particular thing to enter into our head and, you know, register or have an imprint, but its effects are long lasting. Veda comes in this listening part, which is why you see that if you happen to visit some Ganapati or some Veda Pandit, and if you see the method in which he teaches, there is no writing, there is no blackboard, nothing. There is no computer, there is no PowerPoint presentation. He simply recites the mantra and the student will listen to it and he will utter it twice and he will automatically register it into his memory. And this lasts all his life. So we have learned Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu as kids. We remember that. But as kids, our parents have taught us so many other shlokas. Do we remember everything? No, unfortunately, no. But the rigorous training of Veda and that Veda Parampara is such that there are so many elderly scholars, people who are in their 90s, yet when somebody recites Veda, even though they might not be feeling well and they're very dull, they get this gush of energy in their bodies and they will immediately start reciting. That is the power of Veda. So this Veda Parampara, unfortunately, it started seeing a decline during the age of Jainism and Buddhism. So Jainism and Buddhism, they had their own founders, and when it comes to the Astika Darshanas only, there were this Mimamsaka Darshana and Nyaya Darshana who were totally opposing and refuting them. Adi Shankaracharya, he comes at a very crucial point of time, even though the Mimamsakas and the Nyayakas, they were quarreling with them and they're refuting the Buddhists and the Jains. It was Adi Shankaracharya who comes and who gives the final blow. After Adi Shankaracharya and his teachings and his writings, Buddhism and Jainism, they just disappeared from the map. So that is the significance of Adi Shankara. Adi Shankaracharya, he made us realize, he gave that belief that, or he opened our eyes towards our Sanatana Dharma or the Veda Parampara. So if you look at the Vedas and the commentaries, sometimes they might be very difficult. But then we can't say that Adi Shankaracharya dedicated his entire life just to one section of a society. No. They use the word Karunalayam. Karunalayam. Karunalayam is, he is the abode of Karuna. Karuna is nothing but compassion. He is the embodiment of compassion. He is the incarnation of compassion itself. Why? Because Adi Shankara's teachings were never restricted to one particular society. I will tell you. The point here I would like to make is, the Dashavataras, you had a physical demon. But Adi Shankara's greatness is, he is considered to be an avatar of Paramashiva himself. And his incarnation was to eradicate our inner demons. So Kamsa and Ravana were physical beings. And they needed to be eradicated. Inside us, we have Kama, Krodha, Lobha and all these sort of evils, the inner demons. Adi Shankara, through his teachings, he facilitated for the eradication of such inner evils or thoughts. So this is the significance of Adi Shankara. And then when it comes to Adi Shankaracharya, his teachings are not just restricted to the learned men. He wrote Bhashya. How many of us read Shankaracharya's Bhashya in today's life? Not many. So then he understood that as time moves on, not many are going to read. So what he did was, I will try to encapsulate whatever the teaching of Atmavidya is, and I will write my own treaty. Treaty in the sense, he will write an independent work. So writing a commentary is one sort of contribution. Writing independent works, that is also another sort of contribution. Adi Shankaracharya has done it abundantly. So there is something known as Upadesha Sahasri. It is nothing but 1,000 shlokas. These 1,000 shlokas, they encapsulate, you know, they encapsulate the entire concept of Paramatma and Maya and all the concepts which are embedded in Advaita. But then later he realized even 1,000 shlokas would be very difficult for the forthcoming generations. So out of daya and karuna for the future generations, he penned down Shata Shloki. Shata is 100. So 100 shlokas, which are nothing but a toned down version of the Sahasra, Upadesha Sahasri. And these shlokas again, they encapsulate, they give you the summary, the gist of the entire teachings of Vedanta. Then again, he felt people in the future read even 100 shlokas. I don't think so. And then he wrote this Dasha Shloki. Dasha Shloki is nothing but 10 shlokas. Dasha is 10. And then he felt there are some people who might not even read Dasha Shlokas. And then he wrote Eka Shloka. So the same thing has even been done by Vedavyasa. He wrote so many Puranas. I'm sure Professor Sadashivamurthy had spoken in depth about Puranas and their importance in our tradition. So Vedavyasa, the writer of all the Puranas, even he understood that the future generations will definitely not have that amount of intelligence or memory. And then he brought the essence of all the Puranas into shorter works and then even into single shlokas. So that is why those people are known as gurus, Jagat gurus, Sadgurus, because they have the power. They have the power to enumerate the tiniest thing into, you know, we call something known as micro and macro. Even the smallest thing, they will, you know, try to expand it into the biggest form. And even the biggest, the most toughest thing, they will try to put, they can put it in the simplest of forms and then explain it to us. That is the greatness of gurus. That is why we need gurus. Right. So Adi Shankaracharya, he even wrote one shloka which encapsulates the essence of Tattvamasi. I have just given the shloka here. I would not want to go into the meaning of the shloka because this might prove a little bit tough for the children. But if need be, then I will try to give the English translation. It is very easy. So in the mornings, you have the sun with which you can see. And in the night, because of the moonlight, you see. Or in the night, how can you see? Because of artificial lights or deepas. And the eye is also a reason. And then he says, even after closing my eyes, I can see. Even if we close our eyes, we see a light. What is that light? So tattvam, then he says, that jyoti itself is me. And that is what he tries to bring the entire tattvam asi. I am you. You are nothing but Parabrahman. The entire concept of Advaita, he tries to summarize in this one particular shloka. He has written the same concept using 1,000 shlokas, 100 shlokas, 10 shlokas, and even a single shloka. That is the greatness of Adi Shankaracharya. And again, there is another great importance. So there are something known as Purusharthas. Can anybody tell me what are the 4 Purusharthas? What are the 4 Purusharthas? Nobody has raised the hands. Have you heard of the word Purusharthas?
Chaturvidha Purusharthas.
Yes, yes. Chaturvidha Purusharthas lenti. What are the 4 Purusharthas?
Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha.
Yes, very good, very good. Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha. Okay. So, even in these 4 Purusharthas, there is a small division. So, Dharma, Artha and Kama. Dharma is, you know, virtue, right conduct. Artha is, you know, wealth and materialistic things. Kama is desire. And then moksha. There is a small distinction. Dharma, Artha and Kama, these fall into Anitya category. They are not eternal. They are not eternal. So I'll give you a very worldly example. When we buy a new product, you look at the expiry date. When we go to a medicine counter, pharmacist, and we take a medicine, there is something known as expiry date. So whatever we want that thing to last more. That is the nature of humans. So unfortunately, this dharma, artha, and kama, they will not last forever. The only thing which will last forever is moksha. So all our darshanas have focused on the fourth purushartha, which is moksha, because this is the eternal thing. All these things, they keep coming and going. They are not going to be forever with us. But moksha, for moksha, what is the cause for moksha? Jnana devahi kaivalyam. Only true knowledge will free us from this bondage of births and rebirths. It has been written endlessly at so many places in Vedas. But so these sort of, you know, these tough things, Lord Shankaracharya, Jagadguru Shankaracharya, he again reconnected the importance of Vedas to the philosophy, which was lost during the time of Buddhists and Jainas. He again linked to the importance of Vedas and he said, you should do your karma, keep on doing on your karma, and then eventually you will realize all this and then you will have Brahma Jnanam. That is only through Jnanam. Jnana deva hi kaivalyam. Tameva vidatva atimurthimeti nanyah pantha vidyate ayinaya. All these Veda Vakyas, they talk about knowledge. Okay. So that essence he has tried to encapsulate in this one particular shloka. Okay. Now, I'm still going to talk about Adi Shankaracharya. Sir Sharmagaru, how much time do I have? I'll end it in 10 minutes. Is that okay?
Yeah, it's all right. I just need to focus on the qualities of the Guru. Okay, we'll take it that part, little more explanation on the qualities of the Guru tomorrow.
The qualities, if need be, I will again, yeah, I'll finish it off in 5 to 10 minutes. So,
please complete this one.
The first shloka, yes. The first shloka which we said was Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Deva, right? In that I said that the Guru also has the power to remove something from us if we are not in the right path. Then again, Guru, what are the qualities? There are so many qualities of Gurus. One is he has so much daya and karuna. The affection towards his disciple is endless. So in this shloka, what is this shloka? Sri Shankaracharyam Athasya Padma Padam. So there is a very beautiful story which talks about the devotion, the bhakti which Padmapadacharya had towards his guru, that is Adi Shankaracharya. So the story goes, Adi Shankaracharya, after writing the bhashyas and after receiving instructions from Maharshi Veda Vyasa, saying that merely writing is not going to do it, you have to do prachara, you have to go to all parts of the country and spread the message of this Advaita Vedanta. So he reaches Kashi. Kashi is nothing but Varanasi. So in Varanasi, there is a river which flows. Can anybody tell me what river flows in Varanasi, Kashi city?
Ganga.
Yes, correct. Ganga flows there. So this Ganga, which is supposed to be the holiest river for us, Ganga was flowing and Adi Shankaracharya was here and he was on the other side of the river. Then suddenly Adi Shankaracharya had called for Padmapada. Until then his name was not Padmapada, it was Sanandana. That is why he said Sanandana becomes Padmapada. Okay. So then he calls for him and he says, my clothes are there, just give me the clothes. He took a bath and his clothes were on the other side of the river where Sanandana was there. And then his wet, he drenched in those wet clothes and he needed dry clothes. So as soon as he received the, he heard the instructions of Jagadguru Adi Shankaracharya. Normally, how do we cross a river? How do we cross a river? We take a boat, right? We take a boat. But the bhakti, the devotion of Sanandana towards his guru was such that it did not occur to him that he had to take a boat or he had to wait for a means of transport. He simply ran over the water of Ganga, taking the dry clothes of his guru. And this devotion Because of the devotion, what happened was Ganga Mata, the river Ganga, wherever Padmapada would put up his he would place his foot, he would, Ganga would, you know, bring a lotus there, and then he would place his foot on the lotus. Since he has placed his foot on the lotus, hence he is known as Padmapada. Okay, so this is the story behind why he is known as Padmapada. So this story is very important because it shows the relation between a guru and shishya, and then it talks about the acute devotion, bhakti, which the devotee or the disciple should have towards his guru. That is why there is a scripture which says moksha sadhana samadryam samagryam bhakti reva gariyasi. Of all the ways for moksha, bhakti is the most important aspect. Bhakti will cause jnana, and then from there we will have mukti. So bhakti is the most important thing which will lead to jnana, and then from there to moksha. So this is the story of Sanandana becoming Padmapada. And then again there is another small anecdote of Jagadguru Shankaracharya, where he tests his disciple. So probably in tomorrow's lecture I will focus a little bit on topics like who is a guru and who is an acharya and who is an upadhyaya, and what are the differences between these, and guru shishya sambandha, the relation between guru shishya sambandha, and these sort of topics. Okay, but then a guru will always test his disciple, because the guru will always see if his disciple is in the right path. Whatever path has been set forth by the guru, it is the duty of the guru to make sure that his student is also on the right path, because there are so many factors with which we can stray from our path. So the guru will keep looking, you know, the guru will keep looking, and he will keep testing the disciples. So there is a story of, so here there is Tam Totakam. There is a story about Totakacharya. So Totaka is nothing but a meter. So meter is nothing but the way to write a shloka. It is nothing but a syntax of a shloka, particular syntax of a shloka. Okay, just like how you have syntax for computational programs, if then else. Similarly, this Totakashtakam will have these sort of groupings of letters. So the story goes that Totakacharya was not a very bright student, whereas other disciples of Lord Shankara, they were very bright. So then Lord Shankara was about to start his lesson one day, and then he said, Totaka is not here, let's wait for him. Then some of the disciples who were very bright, sometimes what happens is when you read more, you get a lot of pride. We become very proud. I know this, I know that. Which is why our scriptures always say, the Subhashita goes, Vidya Dadati Vinayam. What should education, what should Vidya give you? Knowledge should give you humility. It should make you humble. It should not make you very arrogant. It should not fill you with pride. That is what our parampara says. So, unfortunately, some of the disciples were laughing sarcastically, because they said, even if Totaka comes, it does not make a difference. Even if he listens or if he not listens, it is one and the same. And then Lord Shankara, he just blessed Totaka. And then he started singing praises of his guru in a Totaka meter. So I don't want to go into the meter and all these sort of things. In Sanskrit, basically, there is a syntax for writing slokas. There is a particular grouping of letters. So there is one meter which is known as Totaka. Okay. So one example I can give you in English is, so there is something known as sonnet. Shakespeare had written a lot. You have an octet and a sextet, which is 8 lines and 6 lines. This is known as a sonnet. So similarly, we have a syntax for even Sanskrit slokas. So this particular meter is known as Totaka. It is very tough. It is supposed to be very tough. Okay, that meter is supposed to be very tough. But this disciple, Totaka, he started singing praises of Shankara in that difficult meter extempore. It was just due to the grace of his guru Jagatguru Shankaracharya, and it was also a lesson for the disciples that he should not be proud. Right? A guru will always remove whatever he has taught you. He can even throw you into the dungeon of darkness. So that was also a lesson for the other disciples. So hence, since this Totakacharya had sung these praises, these hymns in glory of his guru, from then on, Totakacharya. So these are some, if you read the history of Jagadguru Adi Shankaracharya, there is a very beautiful book called Shankara Vijayam, which talks about the entire journey of Lord Shankaracharya even before his birth. It talks about the entire journey. Our tradition, usually when ladies are pregnant, they have this habit of, you know, reading Shankara Vijayam during the pregnancy time. It gives you good thoughts, and those good thoughts are even transferred to the babies. That is what our sampradaya says. Yeah. So if you, Shankara Vijaya is a huge book, but it's a very good book, and I think everybody should read it. Okay. So if in that Shankara Vijayam, there are so many examples, and there are so many anecdotes, there are so many instances of how Shankaracharya dealt with situations and all this. I just gave you two stories in that, which highlights the importance of Shankaracharya and his contribution to our Sanatana Dharma and our ancient Vedic tradition. Right. Okay, so with this, I would like to conclude my talk here today. And in tomorrow's session, I will focus on, as already mentioned, I would like to focus on the Guru Shishya Sampradaya and Gurukula Ashrama, the whole concept of Gurukula. You know, when we say ashrama, automatically, because of all the movies we have seen, ashrama means somebody in living in some hermitage, some huts, and living in a secluded forest or something. That is not what ashrama means. Ashrama is nothing but a stage of life. That is what ashrama means. So the Brahmachari ashrama and the four types of divisions, which Professor Rani Sadashivamurthy had discussed about. So the importance of Gurukula system, and then how the guru gives initiation. Our parampara has beautiful examples of how the guru will initiate a chishya, the sampradaya, and some two or three more topics. So that will be what I will be dealing with tomorrow. And in case you have any questions regarding this or anything, you can, you know, post it to Sharma Garu. Yeah. And in case I'm not able to answer it, because I am an Alpagna here. So in case I am not able to answer, don't worry. I will ask somebody else or my guru, and I will try to come up with an answer which will satisfy your queries. Okay?
You're so humble to say
yes,
that.
Sir.
We know that you will able to answer all those.
Okay, sir.
Then we will meet tomorrow. Thank you,
okay.
Everybody. Yeah.
धन्यवादः
थैंक यू धन्यवादः अंदरकी धन्यवादालु
पुनर्मिलामः
ओ वेरी गुड यू आर लर्निंग संस्कृत आल्सो वेरी नाइस अवश्यं पुनर्मिलामः शुभरात्रि बट फॉर यू इट इज नॉट शुभरात्रि नो आई शुड से मॉर्निंग नो इट इज मॉर्निंग फॉर यू राइट
या
शुभोदयम आई विल से शुभोदयम एंड एक्सेप्ट योर शुभरात्रि धन्यवादः
इदानीं मध्याह्नमस्ति
वा अस्तु सम्यक्